I'd like to tell you about a gentleman called Dr. Ashwin Nayak, the co-founder and CEO of Vatsalya Healthcare. Vatsalya Healthcare, ladies and gentlemen, also a Salkalp Award winner, is a hugely recognized social enterprise focused on building a network of hospitals in Tier 2 and Tier 3 towns of India. With 11 hospitals in Karnataka and 6 in Andhra Pradesh, totaling 1,200 plus beds, Vatsalya is the largest hospital network of its kind in India, bridging this gap. Dr. Ashwin Nayak has a medical degree from Karnataka Medical College, Hubli, and master's from University of Houston, Texas. Dr. Nayak, can you please join us on stage? Can you hear it for him, please?
Morning, everybody. Siddharth. I mean, it's very scary to get this introduction. Huh? Okay. Can I get a clicker, please? So I was asked to talk about our journey at Vatsalya and share some of our learnings. So I'm going to do that over the next 15, 20 minutes. Okay, so I wanted to call this presentation, Everybody Wants to Go to Heaven, Nobody Wants to Die, which is a state of affairs when we started. It was a time, I think about 7-8 years ago, when we wanted to launch this hospital network, and everybody was excited, including ourselves, of course, but nobody wanted to put in the money or, you know, put in the help. So let me start with an introduction, quick introduction. We are present in 17 locations, 17 districts in 2 states of Karnataka. And I want to share with you a story about a place called Vijayanagaram, which is about 60 kilometers away from Vizag. This lady, Mrs. Bhaskar Reddy, came with a child who had a condition which needed surgery within the 3 months of the baby's life. And typically, families like this travel about 100, 150 kilometers to the next big town. And in this case, this surgery would have to happen in a place like Hyderabad, which is about 600 kilometers away. So what we do is bring services closer to them. And this girl was operated by our hospital. And within the radius of about 200 kilometers, this is the only surgeon available. So essentially, our business is to bring services closer as much as we can. And one of the great things about doing this is they've actually named the baby Vatsalya. So we have a sort of a recognition of what we are doing. And this is essentially our business. And if you look at the healthcare services distribution, across India, people travel more than 100 kilometers, 150 kilometers to access not primary, but secondary and secondary plus type of services. So our model is essentially, how do we cut down this travel? And if you ask me, how big is this issue? It's about 100 plus million people every year traveling more than 100 kilometers. And that's when we started, that's how we started this business. And what we were looking at is why this imbalance? Why is it that people have to travel so much? The first reason is private healthcare in India is fairly new. It's about 25 years old. And most of us, most of the private healthcare industry is focused on tertiary care, whereas the demand is on the primary and secondary side. The second point, most of the hospitals are in the urban areas, but the population lives in semi-urban rural areas. So we said, can we bridge this together and create access? So our story is essentially, how do we take this problem and, you know, not completely turn it on its head, but at least try to make it tilt. We started in 2005, and the first question that we had was, how do we raise money for this? So me and my friend, my roommate from college, we went to a resort and we made this huge list of friends who are going to fund us. So we had about 40 people on that list. And we put ourselves a target of 45 days to raise some money. We wanted some money to do a pilot and get some proof of concept. So unfortunately, we could not raise any money. And at the same time, we lost a lot of friends. But what happened was, in the process, we found that there are some people who are very, very keen on supporting this kind of initiative. And it's a good learning for us, because we realize these people relate to the story very well. They don't relate to the business, but they think, you know, I'm from a small town, and I think this model makes sense. How can I support them? So these guys actually went out and gathered money, and till date, I have not met some of these people. So they helped us with this angel investment, which got us started. Then we put together a small corpus. We started our first hospital in Hubli. And one of the things that we, you know, realized very early on is when you start something like this, the business plan, what somebody called the Excel business plan, is very different from the real business, right? And there are so many ups and downs that we had not anticipated. And my belief, you know, this all looks like we started with this idea, but after 7 years, I've sort of arrived at this hypothesis that it's a combination of purpose, belief, rhythm, and most importantly, luck. We are lucky that we started in 2004 when the industry was opening up. Impact investment was becoming a hot item, so we sort of rode that wave. So in 2005, we started our first hospital, and literally the day before we opened the hospital, you know, some of us had an emergency and we were sort of sweeping the floor, getting ready for the next day, and I got a call from this guy. Many of you know him. And he said exactly this. After 10 minutes, listen, Ashwin, this is interesting. We want to do this deal. I said, okay. Particularly for us, you know, who are not from Bombay, if you get a call from Bombay and said, I want to do this deal, you expect deal is happening, right? So money is coming. It took exactly 18 months before the money came. So first learning was, man, never underestimate the time that it takes to raise money. And finally, when we got the check, I should clarify, the reason was not that Vinit's team was slow in getting the money out. Literally, we had a business plan which we really could laugh at if you open it today. And then I came across this book. Apparently, this is a common phenomenon. It's not just us. This is the ex-CEO of Burger King. He's the most successful Burger King CEO in the history of Burger King. And he says, if you want to make God laugh, show him your business plan. So this is how, you know, it was fortunate that I took a picture. Much thinner, both of us. And we sort of started with this plan. He said, we'll focus on semi-urban rural areas. The customers will come from that area. We'll focus on towns which are about 200,000 people and sort of build a small community hospital model, essentially to encourage doctors from big towns to go to these smaller places. So we started with a region in North Karnataka, which we are quite familiar with, and established a couple of hospitals. We became a little bold and said, you know, why don't we replicate this in other parts of the, this is one of our hospitals in Hubli. We said, why don't we replicate it in other places? And
I've got some business idea that I just want to tell you about, and I'll be a fool if...
Very quickly.
What is the most popular thing in the world?
Music.
No.
Tell me.
Ice cream.
Okay.
Everyone has it. And what is the problem with ice cream?
I have no idea.
It drips.
Okay.
So my idea is what?
To make a drip-proof ice cream.
No. Oh, that's a fucking brilliant idea. This. All right, whatever. You ain't going to come out with that, though.
No, I promise you I won't.
Well, my idea is to come out with just like these ice cream gloves that make the ice cream not go on your hands and make it all well sticky. And also keep your hands warm.
Okay.
When you was eating the ice cream.
Okay.
Is you in or is you in?
Okay, well, it sounds like a good idea, and I hope you make a lot of money. Good luck, folks. It's been nice seeing you. You take care of yourself, okay?
Well, is you going to be in on that?
Well, it sounds like an interesting
idea. We've got like P. Diddy is going to be in it.
Good.
It is ice cream.
Do you want me to eat this?
No.
No, okay.
What's the matter there?
Lay it on me.
The ice cream glove. That's a C, which means that you can't nick it.
All right.
Have you seen one of these things before?
Sure.
Everyone in school learns these things.
Sure.
Zen diagrams.
Sure.
People who like ice cream. People
who has hands.
Sure.
What's this section here? That's our target market, isn't it?
Okay.
We did an intranet search for ice cream. We come back with 62,6121 result. We did an intranet search for the gloves. How much results did we get? 325,0113. So you times those together, what does you get? This is just people on the internet looking in. 203 zillion, whatever, 496,400, and then a one. Check this out. If all those people bought one glove at $19.99, just one glove, business would be worth, wait for it.
I'm waiting.
That much. That is such a big number, couldn't fit it that way. That in English, 34.6 million billion dollars. How does we promote this company?
So, this is my state. You know, this is funny because when you go pitch to investors, and these are real investors, right? Real partners. If you notice, nobody said the word, this is, they, first of all, they said no, they did not say no. Nobody told him it's a stupid idea. And I was, you know, trying to do this myself, and I was lucky to find this video. So we went around pitching to people. I met 46 different type of investors. Nobody said no. So I assumed they're all interested. So I went around, you know, going to more of these conferences, and they would send junior guys, analysts who will come sit with us, and we all get excited. The entire team would start pitching. And then one of these days, I was talking to one of our advisors, and by that time, we had a little bit of traction, and we got a good advisor who had done this in the past. And he really sat me down and said, you know, tell me what you're doing. So we pitched him, we told him the story, and then he said, you know what, these people are not interested. Then it struck me. This guy is an idiot. He doesn't understand the business either. 46 people are waiting, you know, they're all excited. And then he told me the real thing that, I think the real pitch that we need to make. I think we were spending a lot of time trying to tell people about our model. Trying to tell people about our impact. Trying to show our passion. But what he said, and he had some experience working with funds as well, and I think which made a huge difference, there are only three things. How big is the opportunity? What are you doing differently? How will I make money? Everything else is just time pass. So that was a huge learning for us. And we sort of went back and did the, you know, maybe another 5-6 pitches. And finally, we learned a lot. And now, I think by this time, we have raised about $17 million based on these three questions. I think that's the point I wanted to make. In the process, we built the largest network of its kind across the country. We have 17 locations now. We have close to 1,300 employees, 600 doctors, 5 kids named Vatsalya, 1 house, 4 auto rickshaw stands. So it just gets better and better. Okay, so the other thing that I wanted to talk about is how do you deal with, you know, different types of investors who come in. And in the early stages, you know, I used to speak to Vineet and he used to say, make sure they're all aligned. They're all aligned. So I said, okay, we'll get everybody aligned. And I believe everybody was aligned, is aligned. But really, aligned is a relative word, right? We are aligned in the beginning. We're not aligned towards the exit. So this is a huge learning, and I think you know, all of us have to be aware. And there's nothing wrong with this. I think everybody has their expectation in terms of what they want to get out of it. We just have to be aware and make sure that we are not going with a sort of a closed mind in terms of what is the expectation of different types of investors. But what it means really to entrepreneurs like us is like this story, right? So everybody thinks that the company is going to do something for me, this is something else. All of us are thinking in different ways. The expectation is different. And you know, when you put suits, it looks more smart. But really it is this, right? The entrepreneur is riding an elephant he has little control on. And everybody is trying to make sense of it. And many a times the entrepreneur is facing backwards also. right? So this animal also doesn't have any, it has its own mind. And I think it takes time for all of us to understand. And luckily, conversations like this will help get to some common ground. In the meanwhile, we were also being recognized for some of our initiatives. And one of the big awards that we got was from Michael Porter's organization called the Porter Prize. And they said that we have a unique strategy. And this was the first time we heard that there is something like a unique strategy that we have come across. Before that, we used to, you know, avoid this question by saying, what is your strategy? These are the two things. Number one, stay alive, get shit done. Right? This is all we used to think about. Then we said, okay, this makes sense. We need to start thinking about, and now we have a whole bunch of people looking at it. Okay, so I want to end by thanking my team and also take another 3 minutes to show a video which I think is very relevant to the industry today. And I say this because lot of youngsters today are coming out and saying, I want to be a social entrepreneur. And somehow I get the feeling that the hype is exceeding the reality and people are going to get a shock. But I don't want to discourage. And I think that what people should also consider is look at existing enterprises and how they can help. So I found this great video which sort of supports this notion of being there.
If you've learned a lot about leadership and making a movement, then let's watch a movement happen start to finish in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons. First, of course, a leader needs the guts to stand alone and look ridiculous. But what he's doing is so simple, it's almost instructional. This is key. You must be easy to follow. Now here comes the first follower with a crucial role. He publicly shows everyone else how to follow. Notice how the leader embraces him as an equal. So it's not about the leader anymore. It's about them, plural. Notice how he's calling to his friends to join in. See, it takes guts to be a first follower. You stand out and you brave ridicule yourself. Being a first follower is an underappreciated form of leadership. The first follower transforms a lone nut into a leader. If the leader is the flint, the first follower is the spark that really makes the fire. Now here's the second follower. This is a turning point. It's proof the first has done well. Now it's not a lone nut and it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd and a crowd is news. A movement must be public. Make sure outsiders see more than just the leader. Everyone needs to see the followers because new followers emulate followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, then three more immediately. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point, and now we have a movement. As more people jump in, it's no longer risky. If they were on the fence before, there's no reason not to join in now. They won't stand out, they won't be ridiculed, and they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. And over the next minute, you'll see the rest who prefer to stay part of the crowd, because eventually they'd be ridiculed for not joining. And ladies and gentlemen, that is how a movement is made. So let's recap what we've learned. If you are a version of the shirtless dancing guy, all alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals, making everything clearly about the movement, not you. Be public, be easy to follow. But the biggest lesson here, did you catch it? Leadership is over-glorified. Yes, it started with the shirtless guy, and he'll get all the credit, but you saw what really happened. It was the first follower that transformed a lone nut into a leader. There's no movement without the first follower. See, we're told that we all need to be leaders, but that would be really ineffective. The best way to make a movement, if you really care, is to courageously follow and show others how to follow. When you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first person to stand up and join in.
So I want to thank my team who really do the work. They do the walk, I do the talk. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Nayak. You know, the presentation you had with the guy in the red, it looked a lot like me, my friend. All right, I request you to be on stage with me because we want to give you a momentum as well for that very, very interesting presentation talk. Round of applause. Very innovative, my friend. Thank you. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I have a few announcements to make. We're now getting into a networking break. After the break, we will have 6 parallel lessons and sessions that will be held in Grand Ballroom A1, A2, and A3. The remaining 3 parallel sessions will be in the Pavoy Ballroom 1 and Pavoy Ballroom 2 and 3 and Lotus Room. Post lunch, we will meet in the same room for the Sankalp Artha Grand Prize presentation ceremony, which will be at 2:45 p.m. This is me, Siddharth Kannan, signing off. Enjoy a networking break. See you at 2:45 p.m. for the grand prize presentation. Take care.